All right.
Hi everyone. I think we are live.
Yeah, I think so.
I don't know if somebody on the chat, please join the chat. Okay, guys. So if you're watching, you should be joining the chat and, you know, because this is an interactive workshop. So get ready and get out of your keyboard. So please, if somebody on the chat gives us a ping and says, hey, all of this is actually okay and working, that will be pretty, pretty nice. Anyway. Hey!
Yeah, I think so.
Yay! I don't know. If somebody on the chat, please join the chat. Okay, guys. So if you're watching, you should be joining the chat. Okay. No, it's I can mute ourselves. Okay, so there is a little bit of a delay here, but hopefully we'll get through this. So, hi, I'm Matteo, and this is James. I don't know, James. Hey.
How's it going? All right. So we're going to be talking about the use of promises in JavaScript and in Node. And a couple of important things to know about this is this workshop that we're going through, it's actually all of the material was prepped for an 8-hour workshop that we do spread over 2 days. And we're condensing a lot of material down into just an hour and a half. And we're definitely not going to be able to touch on everything. But we want to go through, the most significant bits.
So quick reminder for you to follow us on Twitter. So at Jasnel, at Matteo Collina, follow us. We'll tweet about things on Node.js, JavaScript. We ramble about promises most of the time, whatever. So let's get started. So, hey, we both work for a company called Nearform. You probably know us. If not, check us out. We do professional services for in the JavaScript community and beyond. And I would say let's get started because we have not so much time and a lot of things to talk about. By the way, we are a professional services company. If you like the workshop and if you want more content, something like this, some consulting and so on, please reach us out. The first question that we have for all of you, it's how well do you know promises? And this is one of the nicest thing that we can ask to everybody. Now, there's a little bit of delay on the between this and that, and when you see this, we will probably just skip a little bit of the answer for this specific question, but we'll assume you know the promises very, very well in this workshop. And hopefully we are going to shatter your knowledge of promises, if we can. And also the Node.js event loop. So,
One thing that's very important to understand is everything that we're going to show you, everything that we're going to talk about is stuff that we have experienced actually out in the field with real code out in production. None of this is just kind of made up, right? These are all issues that we have seen and helped fix in real code.
Okay. Yay. So, it's very easy to do promises incorrectly. Promises are fantastic, by the way. They simply, especially think away, simplify a lot of things. However, it's actually very, very, very easy to mess up. And from my experience is understanding how JavaScript and Node.js schedule code together with promises and so on and so forth is actually key to understand Node.js performance and writing production Node.js code that runs really, really well. So in this workshop, again, this is a shortened version of this workshop, unfortunately. So we're not going to cover all of this. It's just 1 hour and a half. If we're going to go through all those 3 points, which is how promises work, how to use promises correctly, and the cost of getting promises wrong, unfortunately, we have no time to cover the last one of the items. But there is some few exercises. You will see them as part three on the GitHub repo that I'm going to paste in the chat as well so that you can actually follow along. So near far, just a second, and then promises workshop, and then I'm going to copy this and I am going to paste it.
While Mateo is doing that, one of the other important differences here is when we normally do this kind of workshop, this longer version of it, we would typically break everyone up into groups to go off and work on an exercise for a while. We can't do that here in this format. So, you know, you pretty much be going through the exercises on your own. But feel free to use the chat to share ideas. And, you know, as we're going through things to kind of discuss each of the exercises.
So, okay, so let's get started. You will need the late. You will need Git, the latest Node.js versions, which the latest Node.js thing, which is 12.18 or higher, and then whatever code editor that you need. Then please clone the workshop and run npm install. Now, this is the time where we'll typically ask our crowd to run a quick puzzle and do the thing themselves. However, typically this is an exercise that will take you maybe half an hour to get somewhere into it. We probably don't have that much time. So I will ask James. James will actually walk you through the exercise. James, so I'm stopping sharing now, and James, you can take over.
Right, let me go ahead and take over. After I do this, I am going to step away to get some headphones, because, you know, I do apologize if there is an echo in the audio steps in here. Let me switch over to this just real quick. In this puzzle, the trick is this code prints a message to the console, but you are, you know, and your challenge is to figure out what the message says without running the code. And I really challenge you, you know, to stop, take a look at it, you know, try to figure it out, reason through what this code is doing, the order in which things are executing. Because one of the things that we've found is that the absolute key to node performance, to performance in JavaScript, is to really be able to reason about and understand the order in which your code is executing, what bits of code come before others. And to really understand, you know, one key question is what parts of this code are blocking the event loop? And, you know, the obvious answer is all of it is. Anytime JavaScript is running, the event loop is being blocked. Anytime you're using scheduling mechanisms, right, there's some complexity there you need to reason about. So take some time to go through this code. And if you can figure out the message without running it, let me know, and, you know, let both of us know. You can ping us on Twitter in the chat or whatever. Just ask you, don't give it away for other folks.
All right. By the way, folks, it doesn't, you know, don't cheat and run it. Okay. Yeah. Don't cheat and run it.
Oh, and once you figure it out in the puzzle.js, there's a second version here, puzzle.mjs, which runs it as an ES6 module. All we've done is rename the file. The question for you is it going to print the same message? So I'll leave it at that. And Mateo, I'm going to return control back to you, and I'm going to step away for just a second and get some headphones.
Hooray! So we are back into the which file is it? Oh, so they're asking which file is it. Okay. So if you go to github.com/nearform/promises workshop, the file that we were mentioning is on section, order, and first.js. Oh, no, sorry. It's section and puzzle and puzzle.js. So this file, it's this file here. So that's the question from the folks in the chat. Okay, so let's go and jump to and jump into, here you go, the next one, the next one. So now, one of the key questions that you are joining the Broken Promises Workshop, right? So one of the key questions you want to ask is, how does async JavaScript work? Well, this is a nice question, and you should all ask those questions and never take it for granted. If you're not familiar with those topics, please take some time to reason about this. Well, the reason how async works is through the event loop. So whenever you're scheduling something that talks to the network, or you do an HTTP request, or you want to read a file, or talk to a database, or a lot of other things like that, you have you're passing through the Node.js event loop. What does it mean? Well, it means that, you know, you will be called back when something is done, or with promises, a promise will resolve. Now we are going to go through, I'm going to give you 15 minutes to work on an exercise. And this is actually one of the nicest exercises. So I would give you 15 minutes to run this code and possibly figure out some rules about the event loop. Now, the code is this file in here, is section one, order, and first.js.
Increase your font size there, Mateo.
Oh, yeah. Here we go. Better?
Much. So this particular bit of code, it's using a number of different mechanisms, similar to the puzzle, to schedule some functions. So the first thing that you need to do in this 15 minutes is go through, again, without running it, build a hypothesis for what.
Well, also, you can also run it. This one, James, again, if they want to run it, you can run it, because there is the second step. So if you go into this file, you can go to order. There is a README, and then it tells you about first.js, which, you know, try to work out some hypotheses on the values asynchronous way that are run. Then you can run second and see the difference, and trying to understand and adjust your hypotheses, and then run the MJS one, which is the one using async, the one for the new module system and ECMAScript modules, and see even there is even more difference there. And, you know, you should try to understand why that happens. And I know a few people in the audience are actually going to tell that there is a difference there, why that happens. But, you know, it's, I guess that would be it. So I'm going to, with James and myself, we'll probably keep annoying you folks for the next 10, 15 minutes or something. And so on. So that would be pretty nice. And so on. I don't know if. Here you go.
All right. So go ahead and start working through that example. If you have not cloned that repo yet, go ahead and grab a clone of it. Mateo posted the link. It's the Nearform Promises Workshop repository. Clone that. You want to take a look at exercises section one order. To take a look at the code. You can also take a look at it on the on GitHub if you don't want to clone it and don't want to run it locally. The key thing with this exercise is to understand what is happening. You know, build a hypothesis in your as you're going through, in terms of what order things are going to be executing and why. And to really start to understand the differences in those in timing. We're going to go through and start breaking down why this matters here in just a short while. And as always, any questions that you have, drop them into the chat.
I don't see anybody writing anything in the chat. So I hope they are following. So
okay. If you're getting a reference error for qmicrotest not being defined, then you're going to want to do is check what version of Node that you're running. You want to make sure that you are on Node version 12.18 or higher. And if you're still getting key microtask issue, then you're going to, there's some other problem going on. Okay. As you go, if we can ask you, just so we can judge progress, if you've gone through the example, all three examples, maybe just go ahead and put a quick note in the chat. If you are getting stuck on anything, just throw a note in there as well.
You can say your findings in the chat, yay.
Yeah. So as you're going through this, if you're not already familiar, between the puzzle in this example, what becomes obvious is that there are many ways of scheduling code to run in Node, right? We have timers, we have next ticks, we have immediates, we have promises. The puzzle example makes use of worker threads. All of these things, kind of work together to schedule. Just schedule this asynchronous activity. One of the things that is key is to understand how these relate to one another, how they interact with one another, and where in the process of this Node application that's running, where these things come into play. There's a question in the chat here. What is the microtask thing? It's actually one of the key things that we're going to go through in just a couple minutes for those that don't understand it.
There is somebody that is actually making some progress, which says that there is a difference between first and second. It depends on when set immediate schedules, and which he finds very confusing. Well, everybody finds that very confusing, not just you, every single person. And then and for MJS, it says when the microtask is scheduled before next tick and vice versa. All of those things are very, very important bits that we will need to go through and explain in detail, essentially. So
just for the sake of time, we definitely need to make sure that we can keep going on this. So the one thing I will point out with the first and second examples there, note that the first one, all of those things are being scheduled just as your main entry point. So when you node first, right, that code that's executed and run, Node actually loads and executes that file as part of its own bootstrap. And the event loop is not started until after that code executes. It's a key thing that not a lot of people understand. They think, hey, it's running in Node, it's always running in the event loop. That's not necessarily true. The code that's run right when you start Node is always run before the event loop starts. In the second example, though, you're running that scheduled code after the event loop starts in a callback that is called from within the event loop, right? And so the difference in timing, the difference in order of execution of those pieces relates specifically to when the event loop is actually started and whether that code is running within the event loop or not. I should also give you a clue why the MJS version is different as well. Mateo, do you want to start walking folks through it?
Okay, yeah, I can definitely start walking people through this, which will be pretty good and nice. So here we go. I'm going to stop sharing this. And I am going to execute it on my terminal. Okay. In the meantime, James, there is a question. So if you can answer the question.
Right. So the use cases for these other commands besides promise. So it's important to understand things like you know, timers, set immediate, next kick, those all existed in Node before promises ever existed. When they were introduced, particularly when next tick was introduced, there was no way of scheduling this kind of async activity using promises. So it just wasn't there. So now, you know, now that we do have promises, these things kind of coexist with each other and interact with each other. Set immediate is actually a form of similar to timer. So set timeout, set interval, set immediate kind of go together. It's a way of scheduling activity to run on the event loop at a particular time. We'll go through the differences in these later on, but it's important to understand that promises don't actually have anything to do with the event.
James, can you read my screen well, just so that you're there?
It's okay. You might want to increase your font size just a little bit.
Better?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, better, right?
Yep, better.
Okay. Keep going. I'm ready.
Okay. So, you can go ahead and take it off. You know, yeah. We're going into more detail about how these interrelate with the other very, very soon.
Okay. So let's say that we start running our code and say run first.js. Okay. So let's see. Let's open up our first.js file and let's look at the code. So first thing we run new promise. And so we call this new promise, right? As you can see, from the code on the from the output on the left, this is the very first sentence and that's being printed. So this means that this function that we pass to new promise is executed immediately. However, the second sentence is not then one, which means that it will resolve asynchronously. So promises are executed immediately and will always resolve asynchronously. Where we'll talk about that in a second and in which order. The second bit that we are showing is an async function, which essentially it's kind of the same as the previous part. We're doing the same thing of the previous lines of code, but we're actually using the new syntax for them, async functions that have been introduced. So we call our async function and then we call async functions always returns a promise and then we call dot then and then we log then too. This also is scheduled afterwards. Okay. Then we schedule a bunch of set immediate, set timeout, next tick, micro task, set timeout, blah, 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 blah. So let's go through the output order. So the first thing that we see that next ticks as executed immediately. Process dot next tick here. All of them at the same time. This is actually very interesting because we can draw an immediate rule. Next tick is actually a very bad name for something. Next tick does not mean next tick. Okay, it's actually the very, very bad, a very, very bad name and with a lot of legacy, and I deeply regret that they didn't change the name of this API. Deeply. The difference here is that, so the name of next tick means at the end of the current JavaScript execution. So it means that at the end of the current JavaScript execution, that function will be called. So essentially it doesn't even touch the event loop. It executes before the event loop is finished.
Yeah, this is a critical thing, and we're going to show this in just a minute. What exactly we mean here, but there, you know, but when it comes to next ticks and micro tasks, so promises, those do not run on the event loop. Okay, and those are independent of the event loop. But things like set immediate, set timeout, set interval, timers. Those do run on the event loop. So understanding the differences in timing of those things has a critical impact on performance, just in being able to reason about the execution flow of your JavaScript. Very, very, very key critical concepts, and we're going to walk through exactly what we mean by that in just a minute.
Okay, somebody. So let's keep going. Then we have next tick. Then we have the values then. So first thing is executed is next tick. next tick are super high priority things. After that queue of next tick are executed, we run the microtask queue, which was added later in the game of later in the evolution of JavaScript. Next tick was added by Node.js at the very early beginning, and the microtask queue and promises was added way later. So then we have the choose ends that we have added. Note that those, which is one is this and the other one is this guy, those two are like kind of siblings, so they are run at the same in the same microtask at the same level of the microtask queue. So note, as you see, all the next tick queue is exhausted before touching the microtask queue.
Notice here, it's important. One important thing to notice here too is that the two thens are run before the two microtasks. So we have a promise, schedule the dot then, and we have an async function that schedules a dot then. And then later on, we have the queue microtasks here. The reason that these thens come first, right, is because those promises are being resolved synchronously, right? As soon as the code is being run, right? As soon as the new promise is being run, we resolve. So we're not resolving those asynchronously. We're not resolving those in the future. We're resolving them right now, which means that the then gets added to the microtask queue immediately. And it ends up getting added before the queue microtasks actually get invoked.
Okay. So now let's go to one of the important pieces, which is the difference between set timeout and set immediate. Now, this set timeout, we have talked about promises, right? Note, queue microtask was recently added to the web platform and Node.js for to enqueue something at the same level of promise resolve. So essentially is equivalent of running something as a then of a promise. So essentially you can see that then one and then two and microtask one and microtask two are essentially the same thing, are executed at the same time. Now, the next part is understanding the timeouts and the immediates. Now, timeout is actually saying timeout of one. So you can set a timeout of zero, but it's actually timeout of one. So you're waiting for essentially one millisecond. And which is interesting because if we run, this is the first, and then, and then I can open second. So if I run second, you will see that the immediate is run before the timeout. And the code is the same, but then it's run after. So one before, one after. Why is this happening? So why it's happening? Well, it boils down to the Node.js event loop. And I am going to show you another piece, a very dark secret of Node.js lore, which is a guide in our docs that most people completely ignore the existence of that guy. However, it took like the Node.js collaborator maybe 6 months to get it shipped on our website. So you should really appreciate the depth of this guide, which is you can find it here. And this shows exactly the various phase of the event loop. Now I'm going to stop sharing this and start sharing that. So let's see if I can make that transition swift enough. So where it is.
Always pointing that up, you know, a key point with all of this is to be able to understand and reason. Like I said, I've said it a couple of times, is reason when various bits of code are actually being run. When is a set immediate going to run? When is a next tick going to run? When is a promise actually going to be resolved? And when you have multiple promises, when you have multiple of these things that are running, being able to reason about the execution order and what parts are going to impact the event loop versus which ones are not. Go ahead, Mateo.
Okay, so this guide, it shows the various phases of the event loop. Now, you can see that the first callback set of callbacks will be timers.
Go ahead and then increase the zoom on that, Mateo.
Yeah, let me increase the zoom. Yeah, probably better. So you see that these are the phases of the event loop. So the most important one is poll. And poll is where, you know, things are scheduled. Then we schedule the execution and then are actually executed. Things are actually executed from. So looking at the explanation, you see that when we do poll, it receives new IO events and it executes IO related callbacks, almost all of callbacks. So if you do a dot fs dot write on a file, it will execute there. But minus timers and set immediate. So timers of set immediate will be executed afterwards. So after poll, we almost execute immediates. Then we use execute timers.
So it's important to understand, it's important to understand the ordering of this. So if you look at the node documentation, right, it says, you know, set immediate runs at the start of the next event loop. But if you look at the actual phases, the way that's implemented, set immediates that check are actually happening at the end of the event loop turn, right?
Where again, timers happen at the start. Okay. So the problem, the difference here is where you consider the, so it's a loop. So you cannot, if it's a circle, if you pick a circle, you cannot really say when a circle start and finish. So that's the key. That's where the problem, the confusion is. So from an execution standpoint, when the when Node.js enters the event loop for the first time, it starts from timers. However, the next round of the event loop literally starts from poll. So you can actually, if you actually shifted this like sidewise, it will be, you will see that the behavior that will be correct, essentially.
Right. This should, you know, highlight the reason why when you run first and you run second in the order, right? Why the order of the immediates and the timers are reversed, okay? So in first, all of the code is being scheduled before the event loop starts, before that starts running. And what we're doing is we're scheduling timers and we're scheduling immediates. Well, when the event loop starts the very first time, timers are gonna run first, right? And then it'll go do some work and then it'll run the immediates. So those timer output will come out first and then the immediates. In the second example, we're running from within the event loop, right? We're in a callback that is executed during poll, right? And that's when we schedule the immediates and the timers, right? So in that thing, the event loop's already going, and the very next phase after poll, after that event loop after that callback is invoked, is to execute the immediates, and then turn over and execute the timers. That explains why in second, right, the immediates come first before the timers. Being able to understand, you know, reason about the ordering of those events. Go ahead, Mateo.
So hopefully it's okay. I don't know. Okay. Maybe.
What's important to understand here, if you look at this, right? Notice that nothing in this chart talks about next ticks or promises. So when are next ticks and promises invoked? What is the next thing we want to talk about? And I can go ahead.
Yes. So there is a question that if is timer flushed before moving to the next stage, can you block IO by running a timer? No, you can't block IO running a timer. The only way you can block IO receiving IO callbacks or doing new IO is by actually writing a very a lengthy block of synchronous code that will run forever, so that it will block the event loop. Now,
I think we could refine this, Mateo, and say that anytime JavaScript is running, anytime any bit of JavaScript is executing, the event loop is blocked. Which means if you're running JavaScript, the event loop is not turning until that JavaScript completes, till it's done, and then the event loop can move on to the next thing.
So let me start opening up this file. And this file, I just wanted to say, so if you do node first, well, if we do node first.js, you see that it does the timeout and then does the immediate, because it does the timeout and then it does the immediate and then vice versa, right? So that's where it does the trick. Now, if you go into second and, oh, why the hell I'm not, whatever, I don't really understand what's happening to my setup. So if you go in here, you know, if we run second, you will see, you would see that it's actually, it shows the immediate before the timeouts. So anyway, okay. The last bit that is interesting is the MJS part. So if we go and open first.mjs, and I don't know why this is, I have something like that open, you will see that if we don't know the first.mjs, it's you will see that the microtask queue runs first. Then the problems are resolved first, rather than the next TQ. The reason for that is that the promises, so the ECMAScript modules are loaded asynchronously and
using a promise,
and they are in a promise, so themselves they're run within a promise, and being run within a promise has this nice effect of, you know, promise, you are going to schedule a promise within a promise, so you skip staying in the microtask queue so that those will be executed first.
Right. It's also important to understand that the ES6 modules are loaded after the event loop is started. So what you're seeing here is an effect, is a change in the timing. Even though the code in first.mjs is identical to the code in first.js, right? There's a change in the timing because the event loop has already started and you're running within a promise. So that's going to end up changing not only the timing of draining the microtask queue, but also a change in the timing of the immediates and the timer and the timers.
Okay, so I would go back to the slide because I think it's about time we go back to the slides. I don't know.
Yep.
Some pinky slides. So you have some pinky slides. Do you like pinky slide folds? Hopefully so. I don't know. I would love some interaction with the audience, but you know, there is between the
we're getting plenty of chat. We're getting some good chat.
We're getting some good chat.
Let's go ahead and move to the next slide here. So we've mentioned a few times that the next ticks in microtask queues have nothing to do with the event loop. So where do they come from? What is happening there? Okay, so yeah, in Node, right? You know, it's a JavaScript. It's a JavaScript environment, yes, but that doesn't mean JavaScript is running all of the time. The Node itself is written in C++. The event loop is actually, you know, a low level native, you know, C++ thing that's happening. And it's turning over. What it's doing is it's, you know, scheduling some stuff out in some other threads, you know, the IO, you know, reading parts of a file, doing some crypto or whatever, right? It's going off and doing that in other threads. And then when those activities complete, then it will invoke a callback. Now that callback is actually at the C++ level. Some of those callbacks just handle everything in C++, but other callbacks actually invoke JavaScript. And what happens is you have this call stack from C++ up to, you know, through V8, executes the JavaScript, that'll run for a while, and then it will return back through C++, you know, and return control back to the event loop. It's important to understand that while that's happening, while that flow is happening, that calling of the JavaScript, the event loop stops, right? And the way that I've explained this before, think of it as a really inefficient mail carrier, right? So somebody, you know, if I'm delivering mail, you know, I'm gonna bring some mail to Mateo. I have mail for 100 other people, but you know, I give Mateo his mail. I have to wait for him to open it, read it, figure out what he's going to do with it, if he wants to write a response, whatever else. And then wait for him to tell me he's done before I can continue to the next person to deliver their mail, right? And I can only do one at a time. That's the event loop. It can only do one callback, execute one bit of JavaScript at a time. So when we talk about event loop delay or blocking the event loop, what we're talking about is running JavaScript for a period of time. Now, out in JavaScript, we have these this next tick, and we have this micro task queue. These two different queues that are built up. Anytime you call process next tick and hand it a function, what that does is it puts that function into a list, into a queue. What we call the next tick queue. Anytime you call queue micro task or resolve a promise, that function that's passed to then or to catch or to finally are added to the micro task queue when that promise resolves. Those are maintained in a list, and as soon as control returns from JavaScript back to C++, we have a little bit of code in Node that goes out and drains those queues. All right, so anytime this call stack returns back to C++, we say, all right, do we have anything in the micro task queue? Drain it. And after that is drained, right, then we continue execution. We return control to the event loop and continue. Now, one of the key things to understand about this is that this flow can happen tens, hundreds, even thousands of times per event loop tick, right? So as the event loop is turning over, right? Anytime you're calling a callback in JavaScript, you're also going to drain the next tick in micro task queue. Anytime there's any kind of any JavaScript called, you're going to drain that queue immediately as you return control back to C++. Over and over and over again, okay? And then once all that's done, once all the callbacks are done, then we can loop the, we can continue the event. Okay? Do you have anything to add?
Yeah, not really. I think we are good to go. I just wanted to say a few words here, which is that promises, remember that promises are executed synchronously and resolved asynchronously. Okay, what does this mean? That whenever you are calling new promise or you're calling an async function, the first execution, so this when it's executing a promise, you're executing JavaScript. Okay, so you're blocking. Okay, you're always, if JavaScript is executing, you're always blocking the flow of new IO events coming in. On top of that, when you do new promise, the function you pass in is executed immediately. And when you call an async function, that is executed immediately as well. Whenever you resolve, after you have resolved the promise and you do a then or you do an await, that function will be called asynchronously. So in the future. So that's it.
If you go to slide 15, we can show an example of this specifically. So here we
have. Which is this is slide 15, right, James?
Yeah, slide 15. Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
So here we have, these are equivalent examples. There's some details that make these different, but those aren't important at this point. But what we're doing is we're creating a promise that schedules a timer, and then that promise is resolved after the timer is invoked. So we talk about that the promise is executed synchronously, right? What we say is, you know, this in new promise, this function that's passed to it, and what this function is doing is scheduling a timer. That runs immediately. That always runs right now, right? But in this case, what's going to happen is that the promise is going to, you know, be pending until that timer actually executes on the next, you know, in future turn of the event loop. Now, we have no way of knowing how many times the event loop is going to turn before that event loop, before that timer actually executes. It's just going to be some time in the future. Right. Once it resolves, then that then handler, that function, then that is when it's going to be added to the next tick queue. And then some bit of JavaScript runs at that point. Right. As soon as that JavaScript is done, that micro task queue is going to be drained and that then handler is going to be executed. Right. And the async function is identical. Right. You have the async function that is called. It is going to immediately invoke that that set timeout. Right, it's going to immediately schedule that timer, and then once that timer executes, then it's going to execute, you know, schedule the next bit of code to run the micro task queue. So this, when we see in this async function, anything after an await, so you have an await, whatever, anything that executes after that is the equivalent of running inside a then handler in the new promise syntax. Yeah, So here it's just an example of exactly what Mateo was just saying about executed synchronously, but resolved asynchronously at some other point in the future.
So we are 50, we are almost 50 minutes in. We have still have
a lot to go.
A lot to go through and not a lot of time. So that you are aware, be prepared. It's getting worse. So
we should go through this fairly first. Feel free to put questions into the chat. We'll answer them as we go here. But we really want to touch on this. Like, what are promises for? Why do you use them? Like, why do they exist? Go ahead and go to the next slide there. Promises are for starting asynchronous work and scheduling code to run when it completes. If you jump to the next one, what do we mean by async work, right? What we mean is work that does not block the current event loop, right? So if you are using a promise, if you create a promise and all you're doing is executing synchronous JavaScript code, right, then the promise is pointless. It's worthless there, right? What you need to be doing is when you create a promise, whether it's new promise or whether it's an async function, the thing you have to do in that promise at least once is to schedule some activity that happens off the main event loop thread. That's, you know, whether it's asynchronous IO, whether it's waiting for a network request, waiting for some query to complete, right? Something that is being handled off the main event loop thread. That's what the promise is for, is to schedule that and to start that work and schedule some bit of code to run after that completes. All right, that is the only use that is only correct use for promises. Continue.
So let's go through a bunch of guidelines to get promises correctly. So one of the things is always know when your code is executed. And if you don't know, please, it's very hard, study a little bit, because it's very hard. Like, this is a little bit of theory that it's important. Study how the event loop works. Study how the microtask queue works, how a promise works. If you don't know when code is executed, it's very hard to fix certain class of bugs. Then, limit the use of promises where they are actually needed. So, saying, for example, let's make all the functions return a promise, or let's make all functions async functions, is a really bad idea and a very quick way to slow code, essentially.
Right. It's also the way to introduce bugs in your code. As time permits you, we're going to be going through some examples to show why using promises where they're not expected can be a very bad thing for your application. Again, we're short on time, so it's going to be difficult to go into a significant amount of detail on this, but there's several examples in that GitHub repository that go into much more detail on this. So definitely encourage you to go through that more on your own time afterwards.
So never mix promises and callbacks, ever. The moment you start doing that, really, you are getting yourself into trouble. Most people get that wrong. I don't know why, but from my experience, they always everybody get that wrong. Either if it's an event emitter, a stream or whatever, that's not a native promise related. If you try to mix them, there will be some edge cases that you have not thought about and you need to take super care and extra care. So whenever you have to do that, because there's some piece of legacy code that you cannot migrate, just create a small layer that just handles the promises part and then use that instead. And test the hell out of that specific thing. Then please don't create promises in loops. Okay, please don't.
And keep in mind, all these rules, there's definite exceptions, and there's always things that's like, if you absolutely know that you're doing it correctly, then you can do these things. But you have to understand the costs. Creating promises and loops have additional costs, right? You're creating additional allocations. It's the same thing as creating objects in loops or creating closures in loops. These are things that add additional costs and have a performance cost that is non-trivial. So when we say don't do this, what we mean is only do it if you absolutely know what you're doing and understand what the cost is.
Then again, synchronous, don't use synchronous promises.
What we say synchronous promises is a promise that only executes synchronous JavaScript code without scheduling anything else.
Yes. Never do that. Like, if you are in a point of your code where you need to use promise.resolve and you only don't have, you know, any asynchronous action, that think a little bit about your design because you might want to change a thing or two. Another bit, which is one of my favorites actually, it's avoid long than calls. So once upon a time, there was these trend over like the community to use long than chains for structuring your code and doing control flow. Don't. Simply put, just don't. Stop. The more you do that, the more work you put into the microtask queue, the more work you put into in you more memory you allocate, you create more work for the garbage collector. It's just worse. Note that having a long of synchronous than calls, it's actually not doing anything. So I'm not, it's not giving you any benefit whatsoever.
The worst case that we've seen for this are folks that are using the promise syntax and then as a, is a way of controlling code flow, not scheduling asynchronous activity. And what they'll do is have a dot then run some synchronous block of code, another dot then run another synchronous block of code, and all they're doing is using it to control, you know, kind of logically control, hey, I want to do this, then I want to do this, then I want to do this. They're not actually using the promise for what it was intended for, and we've seen this in the wild many times. There's modules out in the ecosystem that use dot thens for this, and it really is an abuse of the syntax. That all it does, the only benefit it has, is to make your code slower. And I'm using benefit there loosely, intentionally. It just adds overhead, right? And without giving you any actual real benefit.
Cool, James. I'm just, there's somebody, it's, okay, have you got the promise map, James?
Say again?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear.
Have you got the promise map article link ready?
I'll pull that up. Go ahead and continue here, and I'll pull up the link.
Yay! So now is the time for error handling, okay? And the time for error handling is that I'm going to ask you to fill in a quick survey. I'm going to ask you to fill in a quick survey asking you what this would do. So that is actually a very, very small survey that would, you know, ask us how things are going. We're using you as guinea pigs, essentially, for our future work on Node.js. So, and it's
yeah, this one's important.
It's actually asking one of the nicest things that we can do. I'm not seeing you responding, so I hope you will respond.
And you know, while you all are taking a look at that and responding to that to that survey, you know, in the longer workshop, we have more time to kind of go in and understand what the cost is, you know, where you can actually, you know, run the code and compare it and see what the performance cost of these things are. Whenever you're introducing these, this synchronous promises and these then handlers and stuff, like I said, all you're doing is introducing overhead to your code. We've made changes. We've gone in and made changes, you know, to say, okay, instead of using this long dot then chain, all of these allocated promises that you don't need, refactoring that and seeing an order of magnitude improvement in the performance of code. Nothing that we're talking about here is theoretical. Yes, V8 and Node can optimize uses of promises to an extent, right? But when all you're doing is adding unnecessary overhead, your code is going to slow down. Your event loop block is going to is going to increase. The number of requests that your server can support at any one given time is going to decrease dramatically if you are abusing these things. And we've seen this time and time and time again.
Some of the responses start coming in. So I don't know if you want to keep it going for a little bit more time, James, or we just jump in and go to a solution.
There's a question in here. How does unhandled rejections cause a memory leak? That's actually critical to understand here in this space. And it's important to understand there are multiple kinds of memory leaks, right? Some are just like resources, you know, by themselves, they're pretty cheap. But when they accumulate, then they become more expensive. Other ones are, here's a large block of memory that just isn't being freed up. So there's different kinds. Mateo, I'm going to let you take this one.
Okay, so let's stop. I'll stop sharing this and I'll start sharing my Tmux, and so that I can show you exactly what I mean. So we have our server as server.js, okay? This is the exact same thing of our example. Now, we can run our server. And if we run our server, I can curl it. Here we go. And it goes into, well, you see here? You see what's happening? This process is not dying, is not dead. Is not getting any answer whatsoever. So the problem is exactly that. So there is no, if we do node server and we can run it with curl-v, you'll see that I'm not getting a response ever. So these at some point in the latest future might time out. But if I am an attacker and I can cause the server to not giving you a response, I can essentially put your server in a situation where it cannot handle any more requests. How? Well, you need to consider that your servers have only a limited number of file descriptors that can allocate at any given time. This limit is given to you by the operating system and limited to maybe 1,000, 2,000, 5,000, 10,000, whatever it is. Your operating system has 64K of those. So, kilobyte. So that's it. That you're 64K. So that's what you have. So that's it.
Right. How so do you? In this case, every request that you get, every connection that is made from a client consumes a file descriptor. Every request that comes in over that connection, right, consumes additional resources in the form of the request object, the response object, these kind of things. So in this case, in this unhandled rejection that we have here, right, we end up in a situation where those things are not being released because the response is never concluded. You build up enough of those, the server can't do anything else. All right. So in this case,
note that only 116 requests finished over 5 seconds. Okay. And you know, if I even run these for longer.
So on the browser side, right? There's a lot of literature. There's a lot of kind of common practice out there that says, hey, you know what? An unhandled rejection, I don't care about it, right? It's not gonna impact much. Consider that, you know, the reason for that, it's a single user system. Those things, you know, it's usually pretty safe. Those aren't gonna be consuming resources from multiple users. But when you have an unhandled rejection on a server that is supposed to be serving thousands, potentially millions of users, right? A single unhandled rejection, consuming resources every time and not releasing those, will ultimately have an impact on potentially millions of users not being able to get that use that service. So the impact of these things is much, much more acute on the server than it is on the client side.
Well said, James. Well said, James. Hopefully these answers all the questions. Oh, I just want to say thank you to Gus that actually provided a very good answer in the chat and said that an unhandled rejection is not inherently a leak, but if an error happens and you don't clean up afterwards, then you're leaking, essentially. So the problem is not that the, is not on the unhandled rejection itself. Unhandled rejection can be pretty okay to have. The problem is that you never know if, you know, you have cleaned up all the resources related to that unhandled rejection or not, or if they will be cleaned up in the future because that promise could even be handled in the future. So essentially, this makes it very hard to reason. This makes very hard to reason about. So essentially, one of our best recommendation is if you get an unhandled rejection, crash, because that's the way to go. And that's the safe answer to this. Anyway, I am going to move into the next few slides. So I'm going to give you a new exercise, and it's another exercise about the about error handling and about things that you can encounter doing things with Eventometer. Eventometer is one of the primitives of Node.js, so you might want to actually look into it very closely. Now, there is a lot of things here, lot of things. So take some time, take about 10 minutes and run the code in Broken.js, and you can see it has an unhandled rejection, why, how you can handle it, and how can you successfully propagate the error, and then keep going, run all the examples up until you go and try to fix it yourself, essentially, if you can. If you don't, you can just jump to fixed and fix it better. That will give you some slight nicer things. And I will give you 10 minutes to do this, while me and James will actually keep chatting about 42.
So one of the things that this example highlights, and this exercise highlights, is what can happen when promises are used where they're not expected. So event emitter was added to Node long before promises existed. Its API was not designed to be able to support promises. And there's a lot of code out there, you know, within Node and an ecosystem that existed prior to promises and does not have promises support. You know, if you're talking, you know, not just Node, if you're talking about the browser environment, what happens if you pass an async function to set timeout, right? And that throws, what happens? You get an unhandled rejection. How do you handle it? What do you do with it? How can you handle those bugs? So you really have to pay attention to where promises are expected, because they're only going to be handled properly in the places that they are expected to be found. Okay. Okay, do you have anything to add to that? All right, so definitely keep going through this example and take a look. Till, why don't you increase your font size there? And just zoom in a little bit so we can see more of the actual code. Okay. So if folks have some guesses here, feel free to start putting them into the chat. Kind of what do we need to do here to start fixing this example? You know, first stop and reason about what happens when this function that does not exist is called. What kind of error is that, and where is that error going to go? How do we handle it? Mateo, why don't you open the still broken version just so we can show this.
To let it right quick. This happens right now.
Oh, this is fun. We're having an earthquake.
Oh my god!
Mateo, I can't hear you. I'm not sure if it's me or you.
Here you go. Can you hear me now? Yay.
All right, we can hear you now.
Yeah.
I don't know if anybody caught that. I just, you know, we here in California, we just had an earthquake here. That was kind of fun. Everything was shaking. That was a good time. Okay. So in the, did you open the still broken?
You want this still broken file?
Yeah. Open the still broken file. Okay. So in the still broken, you know, we had the async function and we tried catch and we handled that and we met error. You know, what happens in this case, right? Yeah, for those that, you know, that don't know, event emitter has special handling. Everything's great here. It was just some fun little shaking going on. We'll have to find out to see where exactly that was to make sure that, you know, that there was no damage elsewhere. But here it was just a nice, fun little roll, nice little shake. So I think I got the dogs barking a little bit. And that's about it. Event emitter, when you emit an error event, there's special handling in there that will say that if the event emitter does not have an error handler, it will actually throw, right? So in this case, we have this code where we wrap it in a try catch, right? And we say, okay, we're just gonna forward it to emit. We still end up with an unhandled promise rejection, right? So again, we're try catching it, but we're not actually.
I love this, by the way. It's like so nice. It's so good. It's one of those few things that make it, well, why did I choose JavaScript as the platform to contribute to? Whatever.
Well, if you want to make it even worse, Mateo, continue on.
We can. Well, right. Which one do you want me to go? Right. Do you want the better or
the broker? But let's look at better, because better is going to give us a false sense of security here. All right. So if we look at better, like, okay, well, I mean, so all we have to do is add an error event handler, right? And if you run this code, you'll see that it actually works. Go ahead and run that moment too. It's like, okay, function, you know, because we, you know, console log error message. It seemed like it works. We're doing fine, right? You know, we're handling the error. Everything is working as expected. What happens though, if inside the error handler, I throw? So open the file, but still broken. There's another file there called but still broken.
What happens here? Amazing, by the way. Note that we have changed the event emitter, the error handler, to throw itself, because you know you can actually write an error handler on an event emitter to actually throw, because for whatever reason it has a bug. So
what happens in this case? What you know, does anyone, you know, have a guess what's going to happen here, or what happens to this new error?
There is the 20-second lag, so James, you probably won't get an answer.
Yeah.
But I can run the code. I can run the code.
Go ahead and run the code and see.
Still going, yes. A nice unhandled rejection.
So here's the thing to ask, though. That error handler is not an async function, right? We're throwing in a regular function. Why is that getting an unhandled rejection?
Well, the reason, James, is because this is, if you look at this, you are seeing that this emits synchronously, which then goes in the error handler asynchronously, which goes into the error handler synchronously, which throws, which bubbles up in this catch, which is an async function, so it becomes an unhandled rejection. Again,
we're still within the promise.
We're
still captured. We're caught within that promise. So again, right? How do you handle this async unhandled rejection?
Well, let's go into using fixed. So let's look into the fixed one. Note that the only way to do this and have these actually not causing problems is to wrap our catch handler into a process.nextick.
Right, but here's the problem with there. If a process next tick throws, there's no way to catch it other than to add an uncaught exception handler on the process object, right? So this is very convoluted, right? And you kind of have to follow the bouncing ball. But the only way for us to actually fix this, right, to escape that promise handling, right? And again, we're using a promise where it was not expected, right? So in order to catch the error, ultimately, we actually end up having to forward everything out to an uncaught exception where we can handle it there.
Right? It's very weird. We can do slightly better. Now, I don't remember if it was fixed better or fixed once. Fixed better. It's fixed better is probably the actual good solution.
Yeah.
So once upon a time, I added this option to event emitter, which it's still experimental because I haven't got much traction, and that didn't got much traction. So, but still it's there, and I hopefully plan to make that the default because it makes way more sense. Now, capture rejection true will actually automatically attach a dot catch handler if you are returning a promise on your event emitter, which is pretty neat because this code will now work and without the try catch essentially, and will not have to do the try catch, the next tick. It's all handled internally by event emitters. So it's way less convoluted and way simpler to not mess it up. So in fact, if we run node fixed better, we'll see that it actually does what we think it would do.
Okay. All this is to say though, right? It would be better to just not use promises where they're not expected. So even with capture rejections here, right? We have to go through this convoluted path where we have to have this uncaught exception or an unhandled rejection handler on the process object in order to ultimately catch and handle that error, right? And we have to go through those convoluted steps because we're trying to use a promise where it wasn't expected in an API that it wasn't intended to be used for.
Like, right? If you're passing in an async function to something, they need to add a catch handler to handle the exception. If they don't do that, then it's a problem. So in fact, it's yes, that James Sumner says event emitter right. plus promise equals no.
We do have a way around this. So Mateo, your fixed once example there. I don't think you've actually added it to the GitHub repo, so you may need to.
Oh yeah, that. I'm going but to add it. So that's...
go ahead and show that. So we added a utility within Node called once. It's this function called once that it basically allows us. It wraps the emission of an event in a promise. So if that event is emitted, it resolves a promise. So we've taken a lot of this convoluted detail in there. And we've actually wrapped it up into a utility for you within Node. So in this case, right, Mateo, why don't you show the example here and what it's doing?
Yeah. So in this case, what we are doing is we are calling the run function. We are adding a once utility. We are calling once with our event emitter and something, and then we await that, and then we await our sleep, and then we do our functions that do not exist. So essentially do not pass. Then also there is also an on operator so that you can use you can use with an async iterator, so for await and it on the events as well. So both of those approaches are actually okay. Essentially don't pass an async functions to an event emitter but instead consume the event emitters from the outside, the events from the outside. So with this, we can actually fix node fix it once, and it actually works as we would expect it would. Okay, so let me add that thing so that you add fixed once.
So we also have, in addition to once, there's also an on utility that when you have a stream of events happening, like a data event, you can consume that using for await. So for await const foo of on.
Whatever. So what we can do is, let me actually try to do that. Once I can do fixed on, okay. So instead of once, we can use on here, and I'll just go to drop all of this, and we can do for await let off on. Hopefully it would work. Okay. Now these will be the exact on is not defined because me doing typos is actually very easy. And you see that it behaves the exact same way and it actually cleans up everything correctly. And we are actually using on this. So I would recommend people to use these utilities if they need to mix promises and async await. Which seems pretty interesting. James, are you still here? I see you dropping out. Well, hopefully so.
Yeah, I'm having some low system resources locally, so hopefully my audio is okay. But I'm turning off video to try to save a little bit.
Okay, perfect. Perfect, James. Okay, so you are here, and so this is what we would recommend people to use once or on. Don't pass something in, or if you do, make sure that you are using capture rejections.
And keep in mind, there's a question I just want to point on this. Will it block events from queuing up? There's all kinds of caveats with using these. If multiple events are emitted in the same next tick queue batch, for await will only allow you to see one of those events. It'll only wait on one of them and you'll end up missing the others. There's all kinds of issues in here, caveats, that typically when we have the full workshop, we could go into much more detail on. We just don't have time to go into all of them now. So we're trying to touch on the basics here. But I understand there are issues that you can run into. So. Hopefully my audio is coming through okay.
Your audio is perfect, James. So, okay, I passed the link. I answered a few questions. So it's probably about the next exercise. And then we have, next exercise. We have time for the next exercise. Like we still have a few minutes, so. Next exercise up is about where it is. Okay, it's about streams and Node.js. So now I am one of the maintainers of Node.js streams. It's so the next exercise is about handling errors with streams and all of this jazz. Now this is actually very, very handy. Like consider this because it's it's actually very neat. So you should really start doing this exercise now. You have 10 minutes, and it's the exercise is somehow is not super hard, but you'll probably need your 10 minutes, and it starts with again it has a no file called broken, better and fixed. And the broken essentially use mixed streams and new promise, which we told you several times not to. Don't do this at home. Now, this exercise is this the fix for this specific exercise has nothing to do with streams, by the way. I'm just colliding two things together. The fix, the very simple fix for this is just a one character swap. You can just swap one character and you just swap one character and this will run no problem. However, this will have big problems with the current things as big problems. So you can run this, find out which single character you need to change to make this run smoothly, and then code potentially a way better version of it. So you have more or less 10 minutes. So we'll give you a little bit of moments before you, you know.
Why are you thinking through that? You're probably thinking through that for the sake of time. You know, definitely want to start working through the explanation on some of this. Keep in mind that promises execute. There's several different terms for it. There's chains, and you can imagine it as a tree. When you create a promise, right, and then you have .then, 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 right? That's essentially a branch or a chain of these things. You know, one promise after the other schedule. Every time you call .then or .catch or .finally, right? Think about what is happening to the tree, right? So .then, when you call it, it returns a promise. .catch, when you execute that returns a promise. .finally also returns a promise, right? So as you're going through and adding these things and calling these functions, like think about what is happening to the promise tree and what the code execution is through that tree. This, one of the nice things about this particular example is that it actually shows, this is one of the things that we see most frequently when we're going to customers and saying, hey, we're having a problem with this, right? Either whether it's catching bugs or even performance issues, is they're following the exact pattern that this example shows. And they're missing just a really simple critical thing here about what is happening in that tree.
Okay. So what should we do, James? We are should we go into the answer or not?
Yeah, let's go into the answer. So there's at least one person there in the chat that's got it. Like I said, there's you can change one character in this. And to fix it, and the question is, with the 20-second delay here, I'll give time somebody to answer.
Question is why.
What letter is it? What character? Right.
What
line and what character?
If you run broken, okay, you will wait. I need to go into the actual folder. So push the exercises, section two, stream. Okay, so I run broken, and it tells us, so if I run broken like this, it's fine, but then if I run foobar, it will go with an unhandled rejection. Now, the problem, it lies into those two lines, okay? So essentially, you are actually creating two promises, trees of promises, two branches of promises. So this catch is not connected to this then. So essentially, when P rejects, when the count stream promise rejects, you would have one rejection will be sent down through this line, and another rejection will be sent down through this other line. So the fix is actually just replacing the P with a space, and then we can actually run and see that these worked as expected.
So this is a case where the promises API, the way it's been defined, is actually kind of working against you. Typically, when we have an object that has some properties or have some functions, right? We don't necessarily tend to think of it in terms of creating branches, right? You're setting a property on it, or you're calling a function on that thing, but you're always operating on the same thing. In this case, this then and this catch has the side effect of creating a separate branch on the tree. So it works in a very counterintuitive way than how we would typically use most objects. So, you know, because of that, we see this problem time and time again with so many different code bases where people inadvertently create trees when they think that all they're doing is attaching a catch handler, right, to it. But it's like, no, you're actually creating a whole new path.
So, okay. Now, I don't like this code, to be honest. It's so old school. You should not use the data event. In fact, you should actually use the new async iterator support. So if you want to receive, to consume your streams in a promise-friendly way, please use async iterators. Async iterators will actually simplify a lot of this logic. So essentially, you can use for await here and actually iterate over your stream. You don't need to destroy it. You don't need to do anything for handling errors. It's all done by the async iterator. So just use for await and iterate over your stream, and you will receive chunks over time. Now, after you've done that, we can actually use an async function for run. So instead of using native promises, we are actually going to use async functions. This simplifies our error handling because then it's not possible to create a fork unless you use promise all. You need to create that. In this way, you can actually, if you're going to await, you're going into a straight line, which will make it impossible to have that error. So please do that bit, okay?
And this reiterates the point we made earlier about not mixing promises, kind of promises and callbacks. The event emitter model, it's a callback based, right? It doesn't expect promises to be used. In the broken example, right, you're seeing just one of the cases where people can easily get it wrong when they're mixing a non-promised API with the promise API, without stopping to kind of think through all of what the ramifications are. In this better.js example, we're using an all promises based API. We're going all in on this in order to get it correct, right? The only other option is to go with a non all, you know, like a non promises completely all the way through. But then the old streams API is not the best thing to work with, so. I tend to prefer this better JS example. So
it's we are 15, we are at the 15 minutes mark to till the end. So you might want to if you have some questions, you might want to start putting them in the chat. We'll go through them at the end. Given the delay, you might the quicker you put them in, the biggest chance we have that we'll be able to answer them. So you see?
So in the full 8-hour workshop that we would do, we have a couple of exercises in that GitHub repo where we actually put some code in front of you and say, okay, convert this to a promises version. This exercise 5 async callbacks, this is one of those. How do we, start, working through and converting this code over? There's another one in there as well. Let's see, what is the name of it? It is the convert callbacks example. It's not in a slide here, but if you look at the GitHub repo, look at those. Definitely encourage you to go through those examples. Don't look at the solution just yet. Take the time to go through those examples, do the conversion, and then take a look at the solution. Compare it and see where you ended up. And some of these, there's maybe some style differences, a couple of different ways of doing it, but the end result, it should act like the solution that you have. The convert callbacks one is particularly challenging in that it goes through a fairly complex, callbacks based example that uses recursion. So it may take some time to really to go in there. Since we don't have a lot of time to go through, we don't have enough time to go through it here. If you're going through it on your own, feel free to reach out to Mateo and I, directly on Twitter and, whatever, just find us. If you have any questions or run into any difficulties going through those examples, and we'll be happy to help you through it.
Okay. So this is the examples. Again, if you want to follow us, ask us, our email addresses are will be in the slides. We'll publish the slides somewhere. Also, you can follow us on Twitter and tweet us. My DMs are open, so just throw stuff at us. If we ask in public, probably better, so other people can join the conversation, but whatever. Also, our emails are matteo.collina@nearfrom.com and jasnell@nearfrom.com, so you can actually email us if you want to. Anyway, this is an exercise of do at home. The reason for this is that if we go in here and we go section 2 and asking callbacks, you will see that there is the before, and you will see that this is a really, nasty piece of code. Okay, note that these are the typical pattern, which is somebody just put async functions in callbacks because maybe they wanted to use an awaiting there. Okay.
So there is a question here that I'm going to leave for you, Mateo, talking about HP framework scheduling request handlers. But
yeah,
if you also look at the section 2 directory there, you'll see another example there for caching promises. And this is something that I want to touch on just very briefly, but I don't have a lot of time to go into it. But it's very common that folks, especially if they're wrapping an HP request and a promise, they want to cache those things. Hey, we already have a request in flight. Instead of creating a new one, I'm just going to wait on the exact same promise. This is something that's very, very easy to get wrong. And if you look in that caching promises case, look at the broken example, run that and see if you can figure out and pinpoint exactly what the problem is. This example came directly from one of our customers that we were working with, where they were they were running with a bug in production for like 6 months, where their solution was to add a timer that ran every 30 seconds to just flush their cache out because they weren't quite sure where the fix was. Took a look at it, and we had it within 5 minutes of looking at the code, we had a pull request open to fix the problem. It's another one of these very subtle changes where you only have to change one thing in order to get it right. So definitely encourage you to take a look at that example and really reason about what that change is and why.
So
ahead, Michelle.
So I just want to add a little bit of parting words here. And
we have the question about HP framework, so I want to make sure we get.
Okay. Let me wait. Oh yeah, let me answer the questions first. Okay. So by the way, thanks Wes to respond to Express. So for all the people that will be watching the recording, there have been an interesting question, which is how are popular HTTP frameworks scheduling request handlers in relation to microtasks, nextticks, and so on. Okay, let me give you a very run through. So Express uses, Express registered itself to the on request, like every framework registers that, and then they use nextick for middlewares to ensure predictable results. Then we have, for example, Happy, which is in the latest edition, it's only based on async await and promises, mostly async await. So because it's based on async await, it will resolve things over it will use a lot of promises. So these are some consequences in how you write the code. Koa, again, is all based on promises. So again, it has the same concept. The latest one, which is the framework that I maintain, which is Fastify, it's internally, it uses its own state tracking, and you can use both promises and callbacks, and it will all work fine. So it depends. We can use either promises or nextticks whenever it's needed. So It's that's the first, that's the, hope that answers the question. Then there is another question about what about mixing async await and promises? Is it all when this is need to go for or a complete async await pattern, or is it fine to mix in both? So I would recommend that in a same function, so when you're writing a function, it isn't promises, new promise or whatever, or it's async await. The moment you are mixing them in the context of the same function, so you are defining, you have in an async function, you are calling async await, you are calling new promise, don't do this, okay? If you're going to, you can have another function that is returns a promise, and that's okay to use in an async await function, no big deal, but don't use new promise within an async function. So essentially, don't do that, and that's actually the best results. So,
Matteo, I want to extend something else on the HP framework stuff. I want to look at our HP example. If you can let me share my screen.
Okay. Yes. Yeah, go share your screen. Wait a second.
So one of the new trends.
You have 5 minutes, James. By the way.
Okay. One of the new trends right now, new things to be looking at, and you know, really, this is one of the examples that, like, it's highlighted by Dino, is this using an HP server with four await request response on, you know, using an async iterator pattern for this. It's important to understand that there is a very easy way to, you know, it works, right? And if you ran this code, and you can play with it, it's in the repo. You can run this.
Oh, by the way, this is Node.js, okay? So this is Node.js.
This is Node.js. So you can use this pattern in Node.js, but it's really important to understand that it's easy to shoot yourself in the foot with this pattern. If we look at the before, right? What happens if you throw an await inside that for await for requests, right? Which is a really natural way of doing it. Hey, we're in this async function. Let's use await. The challenge here is that the for await can only handle one request at a time, one concurrent request at a time. It has to do one, then another, and then another. And by adding a wait, you basically just killed your concurrency. This particular example, if you ran it, and typically we would go into much more detail, is that this particular example can only handle one request per second, period, right? And it's because we're introducing the awaits. So go through this example, go through all the examples, make sure you understand them, and we'll go from there. Unfortunately, we don't have time to go through much more in detail. We do need to go ahead and wrap up. Let's see here. We can pull up the last little bit of slides here. We're going to do some questions and clarifications. We can kind of wrap it up.
James, here. We cannot really see. It's very small. You need to flip your screen on the other side. You need to put it full screen.
My system's delayed just a little bit. Okay. Is that better?
Yeah, press present. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So just kind of finish it up. Again, this workshop is a much larger workshop. It's 8 hours of material. We can go through this. There's a lot of other stuff the Nearform can do for you. If we have any additional questions there in the chat, drop them in. We'll see what we have. But you know, we are coming up to the end of the time, and they tell us that we have to stop right on time, so we can't really go over. So are there any other questions or anything else you wanted to go through?
Well, we might have some more time for some more promises, weirdness, whatever. I don't know, James.
Why don't we throw up this? What was that other one that we had in the quiz?
Let me open the longer version.
Yeah. Okay. And if you can throw that up.
Yeah, I can throw this up.
It's the one with the finals.
Yeah.
This is a fun one. I can throw it up
here. Yeah, I'm just putting it on screen. Just a second. And I'm just leaving it to you. I'm just leaving this to you. Okay. So it's just a simple quiz, and you know this is going to melt you. Here you go.
We'll leave this one for you. We're not going to give you the answer. Try to figure it out and figure out why. Because this one's a lot of fun.
This is amazing. This is an amazing thing, really. If your brain still exists after running, fixing this.
So again, all the issues that we have experienced with promises in the wild with our customers has always come down to people not understanding how they work, understanding how to reason about them, understanding the order of execution, not understanding how they interplay with the event loop. I actually got in an argument with one customer who just absolutely was adamant that when he's called new promise, that was almost exactly the same as starting a new thread, but they were coming from JavaScript or from Java, from the Java where they were creating these threads. And so that was where their mindset, their mental picture was at. There's a tremendous amount of misunderstanding about how promises work. And those misunderstandings are what lead directly to performance issues. To the point now where whenever we go into a customer, if they're saying, hey, our code's running slow, our very first question is, are you using promises? And if they say yes, the very next thing we say is, you're using them wrong. We don't have to look at your code. Because more often than not, most likely, they're using them incorrectly in some way. And just by changing those, the way they're using them, correcting how they're using them, we're able to see 10, 20, 30, 40% improvement in performance throughput, right? And sometimes even much more significantly, right? And it's not just about the execution time. We're talking about memory usage. We're talking about event loop block, requests per second, throughput across every dimension. Just by using the promises correctly, we're able to realize performance for our customers. Okay.
Which is a very good way of saying this. And you know, if you want to give the answer of the quiz on the chat or over Twitter, that would be very interesting to have. You know, it's fantastic. Okay. You know, if. I don't know. We still didn't get one, and we have 2 minutes left. So,
any final questions?
There was one that I answered in the chat, so that should be good. And we got some people giving us an answer. Oh,
with a big question mark.
What do you think, James?
Yeah. So I'll say that the finally three is the last statement printed. The next question for all to think about and stew on and what we have to end with is why. Why is that one the last one that comes out? What is the execution flow through here? And where do we go? So definitely hope everybody got something out of the workshop. Yeah, we do apologize for having to cut quite a bit of the material out. There's so much more here that could be done. We are more than happy to do the longer workshop. It's a commercial thing that we do in near form. In addition to solution development, we also do workshops where we touch on a number of different things. Kind of a full performance overview. Top to bottom with Node. So let us know if that's useful to you and we can talk.
By the way, we'll stay a little bit more in the chat. So if you have some more questions, we can do that. So thank you, folks. And thank you, James, for being my partner in crime for this. I just want to give you a quick thank you. A quick thank you slide. So thank you for your time. If you need us, reach us out at Nearform and so on. So, and you know, thank you all. And they should be really happy that we finished on time. So I don't know how this is actually formally ended, but I hope it's end somehow. Thank you, folks, and bye-bye.
Bye, y'all.
Thank you both for joining. We really appreciate your time.
Fantastic. Thank you for everything.
Thank you.
Seemed to go really well.
Yeah, that went great. You had about 149 at one point, but I can give you better numbers once we pull the data.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Fantastic. Yay. Hooray. Really good.
Really good.
Bye.
All right. Bye.
Bye-bye.